سخنرانی نیوت گینگریچ، رئیس پیشین کنگره آمریکا، کاندیدای ریاست جمهوری. چشمانداز سیاسی روابط آمریکا و ایران، گذشته، حال و آینده. واشنگتن، کلوپ ملی خبرنگاران، 10 سپتامبر 2012، 20 شهریور 1391. در شروع جنگ جهانی دوم، بعد از سپتامبر 1939، به جراید انگلیسی از طرف دولت توصیه شده بود تندخویی زیادی در توصیف آلمان از خود بروز ندهند، چون که نمی‌خواستند تضادها با هیتلر را حادتر کنند و می‌خواستند با کسانی تعامل کنند که تعامل پذیر نیستند. اگر به وضعیت فعلی و دیکتاتوری حاکم بر ایران هم بنگرید، تقریبا همین شکاف را خواهید یافت. عناصری که اکنون رژیم دیکتاتوری ایران را نمایندگی می کنند، از تروریسم دولتی برای تحقق اهدافشان استفاده می کنند. من وقتی صحبت‌های احمدی نژاد را می شنوم، احساس می کنم از ته قلب می خواهد از تسلیحات اتمی استفاده کند. و تجربه من از تاریخ این است که وقتی دیکتاتورها می گویند کاری می خواهند بکنند، باید حرف آنها را باور کرد. این یک دیکتاتوری تحمیلی فناتیک بر مردم ایران است. اینها عناصری هستند که تغییر نخواهند کرد. آنها قدرت را قبضه نکردند تا بعد با وزارت خارجه آمریکا وارد مذاکرات شوند و هویت خود را مشخص کنند. بنابراین مذاکرات آنها ناصادقانه خواهد بود و آغشته به انواع و اقسام کلمات تعامل جویانه اما تهی از معنا. در لیبی در برابر قذافی و در سوریه در برابر اسد مخالفان زیادی هستند که ما آنها را نمی‌شناسیم و آمریکا انواع و اقسام حمایت‌ها را ارائه می‌دهد و به وضوح امیدواریم که اسد محو خواهد شد. اما وقتی با دیکتاتوری حاکم بر ایران مواجه می‌شویم، در رابطه با مؤثرترین متحدی که در میان مردم ایران داریم تصمیم گرفته‌ایم که آنها غیر قابل قبول هستند. آمریکا اگر خطر دیکتاتوری حاکم بر ایران را درک کند، فعالانه با سازمان مجاهدین خلق ایران کار خواهد کرد. به همین دلیل 90 نماینده کنگره آمریکا به طور فراحزبی از قطعنامه حمایت می کنند که به رسمیت شناخته شود سازمان مجاهدین خلق ایران متحدی برای ما در برابر رژیمی است که غیر قابل تحمل است. و به همین دلیل در سنای آمریکا نیز رئیس کمیته نیروهای مسلح و رئیس کمیته روابط خارجی در این باره صحبت کردند. آنها هر دو دموکرات هستند و یکی از آنها کاندید سابق ریاست جمهوری است. من فکر می کنم ما بسیار ساده لوحانه برخورد می کنیم که اجازه می دهیم دشمنان ما تا این حد ما را گمراه کنند. ما سیاستی را نیاز داریم که شدت و تمرکز صحیحی داشته باشد و جامعه ایران را که مخالف دیکتاتوری است متحد کند و از حمایت فعال آمریکا برخوردار باشد تا رژیم را تغییر دهد، نه اینکه با آن مذاکره کند.
Welcome to the National Press Club, and welcome to today's talk on U.S.-Iran relations. My name is Ivan Sasha Sheehan, and I'm the director of the graduate program in negotiation and conflict management in the College of Public Affairs at the University of Baltimore. And it is my great privilege and my distinct honor to introduce our distinguished guest at today's luncheon, a man who needs no introduction. The Honorable Newt Gingrich. Now, as I said, Speaker Gingrich is a man who needs no introduction, but I'm going to give him one anyway. And I should note that a proper recounting of all of his extraordinary political accomplishments and his leadership responsibilities would keep you here for the better part of the day. For more than 30 years, Speaker Gingrich has been at the epicenter of American politics, driving the headlines, leading the conservative cause, and speaking out on domestic and international matters of importance to the United States and the world. And along the way, he's had a hand in shaping some of the most important decisions of our time. Although he's a historian by training, he's spent as much time making history as he has studied it. I'll give you a few highlights. Dr. Gingrich began his career as a professor of history and geography at the University of West Georgia. In 1978, he was elected to the U.S. House of Representatives, where he represented Georgia's 6th District for more than 20 years. He became an early in the Ronald Reagan White House and an architect of the contemporary conservative movement. Beginning in 1989, he served as House Minority Whip. And in 1994, he co-authored the Contract with America and led the Republican Party into the majority for the first time in 4 decades. As Speaker of the House, he pushed through major legislation that resulted in welfare reform and tax cuts and a balanced budget. The Washington Times called him a, quote, indispensable leader. And in 1995, Time magazine named him their Man of the Year. In bestowing this honor, they wrote that, quote, leaders make things possible. Exceptional leaders make them inevitable. And Newt Gingrich belongs in the category of the exception. Speaker Gingrich has published 23 books, including 13 New York Times bestsellers. He is today one of the most highly sought-after speakers in Washington and is more fluent on U.S. public policy than just about anyone I can think of. He's dedicated his life to public service and the protection of freedom, convinced that if we understand the past, we can protect the future. He has long spoken out on behalf of those who believe that freedom is better than tyranny, that fundamentalism is not an alternative to democracy, and that America should stand shoulder to shoulder with those who are committed to human rights, a peaceful future, and the cause of liberty. When Mrs. Rajavi, the president-elect of the National Council of welcomed Speaker Gingrich to her home outside of Paris earlier this summer, Speaker Gingrich expressed his solidarity with the Iranian opposition, and he spoke with moral clarity and the need for change in Tehran. He was most recently a Republican contender for President of the United States, where he served as a fierce critic of the Obama White House and the conscience of the conservative cause. But his leadership on national security matters and his commitment to freedom, these are not partisan affairs. Ladies and gentlemen, when an individual has so many titles and has carried out so many important functions, professor, congressman, speaker of the House, presidential candidate and presidential advisor, commission chairman, elder statesman, author, visionary, and strategist, and of course, husband and grandfather. We bestow on these people the title of the honorable. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming a friend of the Iranian opposition and an advocate for all of those who believe in freedom, the Honorable Newt Gingrich.
Thank you very, very much. I I always worry about introductions of that scale because about halfway through them, I start to get excited about listening to the person being described. And then I realize it's me, and I don't think I can live up to it. But it's a great honor to be here, and I really think this is a remarkable time, and I appreciate very much the opportunity to chat with you today. So first, I want to lay out a framework of thought. I really want to talk about the challenge of morality and reality in democratic societies, because I think it relates directly to the quandary we find ourselves in and to the difficulty we're having, for example, with the State Department. And I want to take two examples, Stanley Baldwin in the 1930s and Ronald Reagan in the early 1980s. Baldwin was a very, very popular British politician. And he came to the conclusion that, and Britain was in the middle of the Great Depression and things were very difficult. And he came to the conclusion that you could not tell the British people the truth about the rise of Adolf Hitler because they would not accept the potential burden of rearmament. And so he clearly and deliberately misled the people of Great Britain about the rate at which the Third Reich was rebuilding its military capabilities. Now, Churchill, who was generally a very generous person, when he was the wartime prime minister in 1945, was approached by his staff who reminded him that it was Stanley Baldwin, the former prime minister's 90th birthday. And they said, "Don't you want to send him a birthday greeting?" And he said, "I can't. Millions of people have died because he refused to tell the truth." Now, that's a pretty harsh judgment from a man who had, in fact, in the very same period, been vilified and attacked by the news media for telling the truth. If you go back and you look at the 1930s, it is as much the British news media as it is the British politicians who are determined to avoid reality. And in fact, as late as the early spring of 1940, after the war had been going on since September 1939, the British newspapers were advised by the government to not be too aggressive in describing the German people in a negative way because they didn't want to make the hostility worse. This was before the collapse of France, before the bombing campaign. And so you had this whole mindset of, can't we find some way to accommodate the unaccommodatable? Can't we find some way to avoid facts that frighten us? Can't we find some way to pretend it will all work out? By contrast, one of my favorite series, from which I learned a great deal, are a set of novels about Horatio Hornblower, who is a fictional naval character in the Napoleonic Wars. And they were written by a man who was about to go on a cruise, and that morning he noticed in the newspaper in 1936 that Hitler had reoccupied the Rhineland and that neither France nor Britain was going to do anything. And he said later on, he concluded that meant war would come, and that meant France would fall, and that meant Britain would be alone once again as it was against Napoleon. And so literally in 1936, he begins writing this series of novels about a heroic British naval captain fighting Napoleon when Britain was alone, because he wanted to communicate the idea that we will survive and we will be able to defeat the enemy. So you have this gap. Those who saw had no power, and those who had power were afraid to see. And I think if you look at the current situation with the Iranian dictatorship, you see almost exactly the same gap. Just as I would argue, the people who currently represent the Iranian dictatorship are sincere. They want to defeat us. They want to drive us out of the Middle East. They want to, in fact, create a world in which they are a dominant power. They are prepared to use state terrorism in order to achieve it. And they're pretty open about what they're doing. And I think they believe it. I don't think these are people who are being hypocritical. When I hear Ahmadinejad talk, I have a sense that he's quite sincere in his desire to use nuclear weapons. And I think my experience of history is when dictators tell you they will do something, it is useful to believe them. It's not just bluster. It's not just... Churchill's position of understanding who Hitler was both morally correct and, if implemented in 1935, would have saved millions of lives. And so it was actually realistic. And we're in a period of total confusion in this city. Let me just give you the most recent example. Now, this is a topic they were reminding me. If you go back and check my career, I have been around a long time. As Reagan once said, I knew Thomas Jefferson. And Thomas Jefferson would have been against the Iranian dictatorship. So I've done this for a long time. I mean, I first became concerned about the dictatorship in 1979 for fairly obvious reasons. I mean, any dictatorship which sponsors the violation of international law in order to hold Americans hostage for 440 days is probably a regime which, in fact, has enormous potential to become dangerous. And there's a new book out by Bob Kaplan in which he talks about the pattern of geography and long-term historical facts. Iran is a big country. Iran is a country of enormous resources. Iran is a country with a culture that is very dynamic and very proud and very energetic. The idea that you could safely allow a fanatic dictatorship to isolate itself from the world and not watch great danger emerge requires repudiating everything we know about thousands of years of history on the Iranian plateau. I mean, it just makes no sense at all. I mean, you look at the geography of the region. Iran ultimately has an impact everywhere, from the Persian Gulf to Afghanistan to Pakistan to Central Asia. The fact is, this is a country with whom any serious world leader has to be aware and has to take into account and has to think about on a regular basis. So as a former historian, I guess you're always a historian once you're a historian, but as a former practicing historian, as early as 1979, I was concerned about the dictatorship. In the 1980s, watching them in Lebanon, it was clear that they had become a very sophisticated exporter of terrorism. Now, there's nothing that has changed in the current dictatorship. It is fanatic imposition on the people of Iran by a power structure determined to create a future radically unacceptable to the United States. And we ought to be, so the reality part of this ought to be pretty straightforward. These are people who are not going to change. They didn't seize power over 30 years ago in order to be negotiated with by our State Department and give up their identity. And so you have to start with, what are the negotiations going to be like? They will be drawn out. They will be dishonest. They will involve all sorts of placating comments as long as they have no meaning. But the idea that we are somehow going, and there are two problems with the current strategy. One, that we think they're going to give in. And two, that we think you can indirectly threaten them enough to get them to change their fundamental nature. I don't believe that's going to happen. So one future is, we keep playing diplomatic games. They keep lying to us. One morning they have nuclear weapons. And I think there's a very real danger they'll use them. There's also a very real danger that they'll just lose one or two. You know, one morning they announce, oh, we're shocked. There's a nuclear weapon gone. We don't know what to do with it. If it shows up somewhere in the world, it'll be despite our best efforts. I think that's a very dangerous. Remember, just because we're sophisticated and we believe in very expensive solutions, and so we build ICBMs, doesn't mean you have to deliver a weapon that way. You can deliver a nuclear weapon in a container. In fact, there's been a RAND study of what would happen if a nuclear weapon went off in Long Beach in a container ship. And it's pretty horrifying. And this is not a game. This is not even 9/11. Add two zeros, and you begin to have some idea what could be at stake here. So one totally unacceptable future should be an Iranian nuclear weapon. This dictatorship, I mean, we've lived with a number of countries having nuclear weapons. We haven't had a country which was an aggressively determined country that publicly says it wants to use them. get nuclear weapons. And this is where we get around to what brings all of you here. Think about what you're living through. In Libya, a large number of people, many of whom we know actually fought against the Americans in Iraq, get weapons and run around killing Gaddafi's people. And do we list them as a terrorist organization? Do we say, no, no, these are untouchables? No. We end up covertly helping them, and ultimately end up overtly helping them. In Syria, there are all sorts of people we don't know who are running around killing Assad's government. Do we say this is clearly inappropriate behavior? No. We're providing all sorts of covert support, and I think we clearly now hope that Assad will disappear. Yet, faced with a dramatically, you know, Libya was not a threat to us. Truth is, Syria is not, they're a little bit of a threat to Israel. They're not a threat to the United States. Faced with a dictatorship which is a threat to us, what do? We isolate the most effective ally we had in the Iranian people and decide they are unacceptable. And this is not new. I've talked about this for, I gave a speech on this in 2002 at the American Enterprise Institute and said we needed a fundamental, thorough overhaul of the culture of the Foreign Service. Because this makes no sense at all. An America that understood how dangerous the dictatorship is would be actively working with the MEK and would be actively, candidly working with every possible group that showed up. I mean, every ethnic group, and as all of you know, Iran has a very wide range of ethnic groups. Every student group, every unionized group, I mean, you name it. I mean, if it was bus drivers for freedom, I'd be for helping them. Now, I feel this particularly because Clista and I did two movies. We did a movie about Reagan called Rendezvous with Destiny, and then we did a movie about John Paul II going back to Poland called 9 Days That Changed the World. Now, the idea that we could not design a strategy against a dictatorship in Tehran, a dictatorship which can't deliver economically, oppresses its people, based on everything I've seen, has lost the overwhelming majority of people under 40, now want change. And the fact that we can't come together and say we should all be on the same side makes no sense at all. And this is why I think on a bipartisan basis, you now see 90 people in the House sponsoring a resolution to recognize that the MEK is in fact an ally of ours against a regime that we cannot tolerate. And I think... And I think it's why you've also seen in the Senate, for example, the chairman of the Armed Services Committee, the chairman of the Foreign Relations Committee speaking out. I mean, these are both Democrats. In one case, a former presidential candidate. And I think it's because when people start looking at this, the current policy, which predates, to be fair, I mean, I'm a partisan Republican, but to be fair, this policy has been going on now for 3 administrations, starting with Clinton and continuing through George W. Bush. Into Obama. So it is an institutional policy of the State Department. And I believe that it makes no sense at all. And I think that the one piece of it, I have 2 pieces of advice that I just want to share with you, and then I'm going to take questions. But thinking about how to solve this, and I've tried to spend most of my career figuring out solutions, not problems, and trying to understand what we could do next. I have 2 specific suggestions. So the people in the United States understand how many American ties there are. I mean, as we did here today when I talked to several different people, you know, you start talking to people who have a cousin or a niece or a relative or a sister. I mean, all of a sudden it becomes a different story. And it becomes a story in which normal Americans understand how they would feel if it was their niece or their sister or their cousin. I think it's very important that you humanize the story and don't just let it remain a political story. The second point I'd make is, and this goes to the whole naivete of where we are in dealing, frankly, both with radical Islamism and dealing with the dictatorship in Iran. We really need to understand, we need to have much more public information, much more methodical information about the level of the disinformation campaign that the Iranian dictatorship is running. I mean, when I see certain articles and I see certain people quoted, this is why we need help. But I'm virtually convinced that they are things that were planted by the dictatorship. And I think we really underestimate it. As a free society, which is as open as we are, we have this permanent challenge that totalitarian regimes and dictatorships have an ability to mass resources over time and have an ability to try to change it. And I think if you went around and looked, for example, at some of the apologists for Tehran, you would find they had very direct ties to Iran. And I think that we are very to allow ourselves to be manipulated by our enemies on the scale that we are. So I look forward to your questions. I think that this is a long, difficult struggle. And I know for some of you, you've been at it a good while. I wish it could be faster and simpler. All I can report in closing is we have a dictatorship which in its mind has been at war with us since 1979. And we keep trying to find some way to be nice to them while they figure out new ways to be at war with us. And I think we need to find a way to educate the American people that there is an absolute congruence between morality and reality, and that we need a policy which has the right intensity, the right focus, which unifies every element of Iranian society which is opposed to the dictatorship, and which has the active support of the United States for replacing the regime, not for negotiating with it.